was.
I
Good morning. Welcome to St. Paul's on the second Sunday of Advent. Today we are listening to the voice in the wilderness. John the Baptist will make an appearance. So let's listen to that voice. May it guide us also in our own Advent journey as we prepare for Christmas. Also welcome if you're joining with us this morning online. The service follows its usual pattern. We begin with the order for confession and forgiveness as found on page 116. Please rise in either body or spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house of St. Paul's Lutheran Church, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Stir up our hearts, Lord God, to prepare the way of your only Son. By his coming, nurture our growth as people of repentance and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing for the lighting of the Advent wreath. Please be seated.
A reading from Isaiah. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide by what his eyes hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, For the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm is read responsively. Give the king your justice, O God, and your righteousness to the king's son, that he may rule your people righteously and the poor with justice, that the mountains may bring prosperity to the people and the hills in righteousness. Let him defend the needy among the people, rescue the poor, and crush the oppressor. May he live as long as the sun and moon endure, from one generation to another. Let him come down like rain upon the mown field, like waters that water the earth. In his time may the righteous flourish, and let there be an abundance of peace till the moon shall be no more. Blessed are you, Lord God, the God of Israel. You alone do wondrous deeds. And blessed be your glorious name forever. And may all the earth be filled with your glory. Amen. Amen. A reading from Romans. Whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you, for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will confess you among the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. And again he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the people praise him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse shall come, the one who rises to rule the Gentiles. In him the Gentiles shall hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the third chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him, and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now, the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
For the children's message this morning, I was thinking of a popular Christmas song. Perhaps you know some of the words of it. It goes a little bit like, "You better watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout, I'm telling you why." And why is that? Santa Claus is coming to town, right? Right? So it's a little bit of a preparation. You know, this song is telling folks about Santa and what not to do. You better not pout, you better not cry, you better watch out. Not quite sure what the watch out part means, but you know, just this idea of preparing for Santa, somebody special who's coming to town. In today's gospel reading, we learn a little bit about John the Baptist, someone else who is quite special, who maybe is not coming to town, but coming to the river, and also inviting us to come to the river as well. So these parts of the gospel, this idea of preparation and what to do, kind of preparing for Jesus in our lives and preparing for when Jesus would be coming. I pulled the character that is in the Sunday school lesson today, a picture of John the Baptist, and I think the person who drew this has a little bit of an imagination. The Bible doesn't tell us much about what John looked like other than what he wore, and that he was a man who ate locusts and wild honey. I'm guessing many of us probably have had honey. I don't know how many of us have had a locust in our lives. I know I've had a cricket. Went to Mexico one time and ate fried crickets, so maybe that's the closest thing to a locust. But this getting ready for Christmas, John also reminds us that maybe it's not so much about you know, our stuff that we're getting ready at this time of year, but more perhaps our hearts in getting ready for Jesus and getting ready in that sense and paying less attention to our stuff and preparing our hearts for Jesus. So let us pray. Dear God, we wish that we always know that you are with us in our hearts. In your name we pray. Amen. There's a favorite, very favorite family story that we love to tell. Years ago, according to my husband, while both of us were in a very deep sleep, in the middle of the night, he says that he saw me sit up in bed, eyes wide open, and I announce, "Be prepared, Jesus is coming." He said I looked at him with my eyes wide open, I laid back down and went back to sleep. Needless to say, Bill did not go back to sleep. He was left with eyes wide open. Be prepared, Jesus is coming. During this season of Advent, for some of us, this word prepare can immediately give us some level of anxiety or angst. This idea that we need to prepare, and even if we aren't the kind that are running around and doing the things that we feel we need to do in this season, we do feel that we need to be doing something. The whom, the what, the where, who do we buy for, what do we buy? That what part is usually what gives me a lot of angst. I can hardly ever figure out what to get people. And then when to fit it all in, the shopping, the baking, the cooking, and even the end of the year stuff that our jobs bring us, you know, the end of the year goals that we need to have markers for, or those employee evaluations that we need to finish up. All of these things are layers that occur during this end of the year as we prepare during this Advent season. Prepare the way of the Lord. In our preparation of this text and of this season, I thought we could take a closer look at the words in this verse, prepare the way of the Lord. There are two words in particular, the way. Prepare the way. There's a Jesus movement and followers of Jesus that were referred to as the way. Jesus is the way. You can learn more about the way in the book of Acts. But during this Advent time, as we are preparing for Jesus, who comes to us as a baby and lived with us, God becomes the way. The way to God through Jesus. Jesus finds his way to us, whether we are prepared or not. Advent reminds us that the Jesus of the cross was once a Jesus in the manger. We like this image of a child, an infant needing us to care for him, a Jesus that is cute and cuddly. The text today, I think, is also a reminder that John the Baptist is preparing us in this time of Advent, a reminder that the birth of Jesus, of God who became human, is because God so loved the world and that God loves us and wishes to care for us. So in order to prepare the way of the Lord, we need to find Jesus as both baby and the comfort of the manger, a reminder of God made human, and find Jesus as John is preparing us for, the adult Jesus, in what might be a more uncomfortable image of Jesus on the cross. But it is one that reminds us what Jesus did for us. Either way, the path to Jesus is one to the manger and one to the cross. Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Perhaps the text here is to make his path straight is not just for us to go to God, but also the way of the Lord who comes to us, who finds us exactly where we are. In return, God's way gives us purposeful movement, a path, a way, a route, when we feel we are wandering, in need of rescue, in need to be found in our own wilderness. This path made straight is exactly what our main character in today's text, John the Baptist, has to offer us. John is inviting all of Judea, all people, to come to a new way, a way of freedom, liberation, and peace. Come to a new life, this new way. John the Baptist's appearance in the wilderness must have been quite something. He's described as a man who wore clothing of camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist. He ate food like wild honey and locusts, which actually we might call a paleo diet today. I understand there's a lot of protein in locusts. And although the text does not have exclamation marks behind much of what John had to say, I'm imagining that someone who's speaking in the wilderness must be shouting to be heard, "Be prepared! Jesus is coming! Repent!" John the Baptist, cool guy or wild guy, he's got our attention. Imagine getting a text from a friend that says, "Hey, let's go see this guy down by the river. He's baptizing and he's crying out, "We can't be left out." So we're curious. We're curious. We go to see him. The gossip on the street is that we have to go see this man who is baptizing, called the baptizer, who's telling us to repent, for the kingdom of God is near. This voice in the wilderness. I'm imagining that John's appearance and voice of confidence and thunder to repent and prepare and to put on notice that there is one who is coming who is more powerful than he, one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit and fire. This John was quite different from what had happened perhaps maybe about 30 years prior in the town of Bethlehem. A much quieter image we are given when we think of the Christ child in the manger. How silently the wondrous gift is given. And yet in both instances, John in the wilderness or Jesus in the manger, there seems to be this urgency by those who want to come and see, those who follow a path, the way made straight to Christ. Little did they know that the path made straight was also for Christ to come to them. Just as we imagine the morning stars together proclaim the holy birth, we can think of John as the forerunner, the proclaimer, and like the Star of Bethlehem, John is a sign with an alluring and captivating appearance, a shining light inviting us to a life with Jesus. And in this divine invitation, John commands us to repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. The first thought usually comes to mind, at least for me when I read this text at first, when we think of this word repent, is to confess or to ask for forgiveness. And there is truth, certainly, in confession, and we do this on our own as well as at the beginning of every worship service. But in this instance, repent, in the Greek terms, is the word metanoia. Metanoia. Metanoia does not mean confession or forgiveness. It means a changed mind, the heart of the matter, to change your mind, to change your heart, to change your life. Being sorry for the past, certainly, but the focus is not on what was done or left undone. The focus is on the change of life going forward, a change that creates a more life-giving future. What changes? Exactly. John sums it up as saying bearing fruit. He says, bear fruit worthy of repentance. To bear fruit, you must change your heart, change your mind, and the direction in which you are looking for happiness. Father Thomas Keating, in his book, The Mystery of Christ, says this: a fruitful and happy life can only be found in the direction and path made straight of God and with God. This change also unites us to everyone else in the human family and to all creation. In today's text, John is actively baptizing people in the Jordan River. He's borrowing an ancient Jewish tradition of baptizing Gentiles to convert them to Judaism. But here, John calls everyone to the river, even the religious insiders. A new day is here, and God calls everyone. No one is excluded. For many of us, life does not come perfectly in our lifetimes. Issues arise within families and friends, with our work, with our health, with our reputations. The ends of our lives may come as life unfinished and incomplete, and maybe even a life of brokenness. This act of baptism is an invitation for the broken and imperfect and lost to receive forgiveness of sins, to change and truly transform your life. Baptism means to face a certain amount of death as we let go and move on to new creation and to new life. But John says that there is one coming after him, one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire. I love this image of baptism with the Holy Spirit and fire. God is on the move, and a new way is opening up. A new path is becoming possible. A fire will be ignited within you, changing you from the inside out. A fire, an infusion of energy, a fresh start, a new chapter. What we long for is happening. A change of mind, a change of heart, a change of life in this path to follow the way of Jesus. This announcement of Jesus' arrival doesn't seem inclusive, however. It seems to leave some people out. The part of this reading has been read about, generally about separating the good people from the bad people, Judgment Day. But if you read this a little differently, perhaps the opposite of what John had in mind, you know, imagine Jesus with a pitchfork on the threshing floor and the granary and working through the chaff. And the word fire is used again as the chaff being burned in an unquenchable fire, a never-ending fire. What does that mean? What is this chaff? So like a cob of corn with a husk, every grain of wheat has a husk. Farmers use wind to separate the grains of wheat from the husk called the chaff. The grains stay together while the chaff goes off wherever it wants. And the goal is to save every grain, not to separate the good grain from the perceived bad grain. If we are the grains of wheat, the goal of Jesus is to gather us to stay together. And John gives us an image of unity, not division. What the wind and fire remove are the husks of the grains of wheat. Let us think of those husks, this chaff, as those things that get in our way. Things like anxiety, self-absorption, lack of concern or interest, greed. Those things, the chaff that makes us less generous, less respectful, less just, less loving. And this is exactly how the wind and fire of the Holy Spirit works, not to destroy, but to bless, refine, challenge, restore, and empower us. John, too, will baptize in the transformative and restorative, liberating, freedom-like way, adding to the cleansing power of water and the refining, liberating power of fire, burning away the husks and the chaff of our lives that hold us back from metanoia and bearing good fruit. In this season of being prepared, Jesus is coming. We are reminded of God who became human and in and through whom we are baptized, who invites us to metanoia and transformation and change, a life going forward, a life-giving future, who preserves the good in us so that we might keep our eyes wide open to bear good fruit and to discover the way of Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed as found on page 105. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we prepare for the fullness of Christ's presence, let us pray for a world that yearns for new hope. This week's response is, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
God, you renew the church in every age. We give thanks for hymn writers and theologians, especially John of Damascus, whom we commemorate today. Inspire teachers, writers, and musicians to delight and instruct your people. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You give us a vision of creation in harmony, when hurting and destruction will be no more. Teach us to be stewards of the earth and companions to its creatures. Restore to balance and wholeness what human greed has harmed. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You defend the cause of all who are poor and oppressed. Raise up leaders who will govern with equity and serve the common good. Guide judges, lawmakers, and public officials to protect the rights of those who cannot advocate for themselves. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You deliver those in need from suffering and fear. Come to the aid of any who are exploited or abused, especially children, elders, and victims of human trafficking. Provide safety and help to our neighbors without shelter, refugees, and those fleeing violence. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You urge your people to welcome one another as you have welcomed us. Nurture ministries of hospitality and care in this and every congregation. We pray for people who are homebound, hospitalized, sick, or separated from loved ones, especially all those on our prayer list. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You embrace all who have died, especially Pastor Ken Smith, trusting in your promises, and we give thanks for their faithful witness. Sustain us in hope until we are united with them in the joy of your eternal presence. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. God of our longing, you know our deepest needs. By your Spirit, gather our prayers and join them with the prayers of all your children. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Please rise. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us take a moment to share God's peace with one another.
Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence, in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you also will make all things new, in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join the unending hymn. Name of the Lord, Hosanna. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Communion today is celebrated in the center aisle. We will begin with the left side and then continue with the right and the transept. I know it is the first Sunday of the month, but because of the Advent wreath, it's going to be a little complicated serving communion around the rail, so therefore we will return to doing that in the new year, most likely on January 8th. Because January 1st, we only have one service without communion. Now taste and see that the Lord is good. Thanks be to God. Please rise. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning. First, you heard it in the prayers today, Pastor Ken Smith, who actually joined last week on Sunday in absence. He was still talking to his good friend, almost adopted son, Bob McMillan, in the morning, but later on in that day died and went to be with Jesus. So we are with his friends and family in our prayers, but we also will be gathering here tomorrow at 11 a.m. To celebrate the service of life for him, and there will be a calling hour from 10 to 10:45. Please keep all family and loved ones in your prayers. Also this week coming up, well, actually, first of all, coming up in a couple minutes from now is caroling around the fireplace. Please join us for that if you'd like, and you can choose your favorite carol. We have carol books there. If you don't remember all the verses to the text, like I remember the first line of every carol, but then it gets a little murky. So anyways, are there any other announcements? Yes, come on up. Don't be shy. By the way, I'm double sad today. Germany out in the first round, you know, and then U.S. out yesterday. But I still have one iron in the fire. South Korea is still in the running, so.
Good morning. I'm sure most of you saw when you came in, there's what we call a pop-up Christmas sale. Basically, it's for donations for the pastor's discretionary fund. So if you see something you like, please make a donation and take it along home with you. And likewise, we're going to do it again next week. If you have extra ornaments that you're not using or no longer need and want to put them out for redistribution among the congregation, then please do that as well. Thanks again.
Can you smell them? Cookies are baking. And next week is cookie time, so get yourself signed up if you want to make sure that you get some as a buyer. And we also could use more bakers and packers if you want to come on Friday night and join the fun, or Saturday morning. It's always a wonderful time. So join us if you can and sign up, please.
Well, next week, also coming up at the late service, the annual Santa Lucia celebration. Please keep all the participants in your prayers as we prepare for this event. A lot of moving parts have to come together, and we give thanks for everyone who is involved in it. Yesterday, we had Pages to Pirouettes once again performing the Nutcracker. And this year, they were back with the residents from Shenandoah Retirement Community. It was a delight. We had close to 70 people in attendance, and it really was wonderful. So in that spirit, go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Mike and Sue.